Good morning and welcome to worship here at Lochbroom Ullapool Church of Scotland. I am Reverend Heidi and thank you for joining us this morning for worship. Worship not as we know it or how we're used to, but worship for the time being. So thank you for joining us this morning as we sing and pray and praise and listen to God's word together. So a warm welcome to any who are joining us for the first time, a warm welcome to those who join us every time, and a warm welcome to those who join us somewhere in the middle. Thank you. May you be blessed by the service today and be encouraged by the service this morning. Please, and as usual, there will be two hymns throughout the service, two well-known hymns. Please do, in the company of your own home, in the privacy of your own home, please do join in singing our worship songs with us. Let us worship God. Please listen for the call to worship. Jesus Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Christ is risen indeed. God is alive. New birth is given. Hope is alive. A new age is dawning. Joy is alive. Redemption is here. Love is alive. Death cannot harm us. We are alive. A new life within us. The church is alive. God's Spirit is within us. God of life, we worship you. God of creation, we praise you. God of revelation, we learn from you. And God of resurrection, we come to celebrate you. Let us pray. Loving God, a week ago we remembered the old story of an empty tomb. A week ago you shattered the power of death. But the world doesn't seem all that different today. In fact, the world seems a very different place than a world we are used to. But as we share more of the old story, as we pray and as we sing and as we reflect, I pray that you move in our hearts. Help us to see the possibilities of a world where resurrection joy is a reality. And then when I'm done with this service today, help us to live as different people. People who know that life wins, that love wins, that you conquer death. Help us even when we are most doubtful. Help us to remember that life always and still wins. God of Easter, it is easy to doubt. It's easy to be skeptical. It's easy to wonder what the truth actually is. Especially now, it's hard to hope for the best. And it's hard to believe in something we cannot see. It can be hard to accept things that don't match our expectations or our experiences. And yet, despite it all, you call us to be people of faith and trust. Give us the freedom to ask our questions so that our faith can grow. Give us the openness of heart and mind that allows for new understanding and stretches us to see the world in new ways. God of surprises and challenges, God made known in the risen Christ, you meet us in our doubts, in our fears, and in our faith. And for that, we are truly thankful. Amen. This morning, I have simply chosen just two of my favorite hymns that I think you will quite easily sing along with at home. And I will give the usual apology of the noise that comes out of me in the next 30 seconds or so. So, Tony, if you could start, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
Mm-hmm.
Always love that one. I do not have a children's address today. I'm grateful for Tony doing his one last week, but I will move right into the scripture today. And the scripture today is a well-known passage that usually does come up the weekend, the week after Easter, and it's the road to Emmaus. And I think this story is just as relevant to us today, but also I think of a time where people are getting out and walking more than usual, trying to get our exercise, trying to, in beautiful weather like this, taking walks, taking journeys, and there's often much to see and learn and to be revealed and to reflect upon, of course, in those walks. And so today's scripture lesson is about the road to Emmaus and a time of revelation. So it is quite a longer scripture this morning, so I will get right into it. I am reading from Luke chapter 24, starting at verse 13, and I'm going all the way to 33. Now the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, Are you the only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that he'd seen a vision of angels, who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the woman had said, but they did not see Jesus. He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Messiah have to suffer those things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him strongly, "Stay with us." For it was nearly evening. The day was almost over. So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And then he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us when we talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" And they got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together, and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God. And I'm going to pray and then share some thoughts with you about this journey on the road. Pray. Dear Lord, we come to worship in this way that is different for us, not the way I'm used to or the way a congregation is used to, but however we come, wherever we are just now, we come to you with open hearts. Give us ears to hear. Take us for what we are. Stir in our hearts. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart and mind be acceptable and pleasing to you, Lord Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen. So I want to share a little story with you. And it's one of my favorites. And yes, if you are one of my flock, you're going to say, "She's told us that one before." But I really like this. And I think it's quite funny. And quite appropriate, I think, considering your Lochbroom Ullapool parish minister had something to do with the Easter Bunny this year. So I think it's quite a funny little story. So, a minister and her parishioner were heading out very early in the morning to catch the Easter sunrise service. As they walked and talked, suddenly, they looked up ahead to see the Easter Bunny down on the ground in the middle of the road, looking lifeless. Eggs had exploded and chocolate eggs were everywhere. And the minister and her parishioner didn't know what was going on. They didn't know if this was sheer exhaustion from the overworked Easter Bunny or if this had just been an accident. The two ran over to help it, but it was too late. "Oh no," the minister shouted, and she began to cry. "Kids will have to go without their Easter eggs, and there will be much sadness in the village of Ullapool today." But then the parishioner said, "Wait a minute, and she started digging through her handbag. After a slightly frantic search, she produced a type of spray bottle that she rushed to the bunny's limp body and began covering it up with this spray. Then she backed away. And in a few moments, miraculously, the Easter bunny jumped to his feet. And he waved. And it quickly gathered up the spilled eggs and candy, and then it waved again. It kept kind of waving. And it hopped about 50 yards and turned around and again waved. The minister was ecstatic, excited, delighted, joyful, gleeful almost. She clapped her hands and asked excitedly, "What was in that bottle? Was it holy water? Was it Seven Crofts gin? Was it whiskey?" The parishioner said, No, minister. It was my hair restorer with a permanent wave. It brings new life to dead hair and adds a permanent wave." Okay. That's not a true story, by the way. But a silly story, but a story of excitement that happened on a road. And this morning, I want to unpack that scripture passage that I just read about a story that happens on a road. The road to Emmaus. And as Christians, this is a very important passage because throughout our journey in life and throughout our walk with Christ, there's often a defining moment as we're kind of plodding through life that where God is kind of always in the midst of plodding through life, but sometimes we lose focus on where God is in our daily living. And so we kind of sometimes speak about this Emmaus Road moment where suddenly something happens, some encounter happens, some circumstance happens, maybe meeting another person, maybe an opportunity arises, but somehow along the journey of life, Jesus is revealed to us in some way. And so suddenly our eyes are open and we're alive to who this Jesus is working in our lives. And we're kind of changed forever. Jesus' life and his death and his resurrection suddenly become so alive to us. And we're excited about it. We want to share that moment with someone else. And we're almost feeling compelled to walk with Christ stronger and deeper, and we can't wait to share how Christ has changed us, and we can commit our lives to Christ and decide to follow him wherever that journey takes us. That's kind of an Emmaus Road moment. And for some of us who walk with the Lord, some of that Emmaus moment, road moment might be very striking, and for some it might be very subtle. But it's a moment where you truly have Christ revealed to you in a personal way, and you say, "I'm ready to walk with you fully and give you my all." So that's what happened on this journey today. And I want us to think about our journey with Christ this morning. And I want us to think about where we are in our journey with Christ. Are we like these two people journeying on the road before they met Jesus? Or is our walk with Christ more like their excited way they were after Jesus had left? So let's just think about that this morning. When they started on this road, they just lost their friend. They just lost their dearest friend. We don't know exactly how close they were, but Jesus clearly was a dear friend, and they're walking down this road, and they're disappointed, and they're doubtful, and they're disillusioned, and they're defeated, and they're discouraged. All these kind of D words, and they're thinking about despair. And of course, they're thinking about the death of their best friend. And they're walking along carrying all that. And they had left the other disciples and they're journeying on this road to Emmaus. The disciples themselves were confused and afraid and bewildered, and they were all gathering together in a separate place. But these two men were traveling along. Their master, who they loved, had been horribly put to death, a cruel death. And in that death, despite what Jesus said, their hopes were dashed, their dreams dashed. And even the report of Mary and the other women running and telling the disciples, Jesus has risen, the tomb is empty, even that confused them. They didn't get it. They didn't want to take it in. They couldn't take it in. And the scripture reading I said, you know, kind of clears up their situation. It sums up the situation. They said, we had hoped. We had hoped that Jesus would be the one who was going to set us free. We had, past tense, hoped. They were saying they didn't expect it now, that all hope was lost. They had high hopes for the future, and the hopes now dashed away. So they're only left with disappointment, discouragement, disillusion, despair. They're despondent. And I wonder, in the midst of all this corona stuff, if those D words are affecting us in any way. Can we identify with the feelings of these disciples? Because how we react and respond to circumstances is different. How we are all responding and reacting to coronavirus, COVID-19, whatever we want to call it, we are all responding in some way. And I think we'd be rare people indeed not to be feeling any of this discouragement or depression or despair or doubt or disappointment. I think we're all in that camp together. But do we have to stay there? Does staying there do us any good? So as these two men, you kind of can imagine they're kind of heads down, something along, a stranger joins them. And this was going to be the most significant walk of their entire lives. This stranger joins them and asks, what are you talking about? And they think this stranger is just a weirdo, because how can you be walking around and not know the events that have just happened? So they are kind of, they tell them all their hopes and their disappointments and what their sound seems like. They kind of cried out their hearts to this stranger. But sometimes a stranger is easier to let your heart out to. So they're letting their heart out to them, and Jesus just listens. He doesn't give them a pep talk. He doesn't say, oh, get over it. He doesn't try to cheer them up or snap out of it. He just listens as he walks, as they walk together. Now, we know from the reading of the text the stranger is Jesus, but they do not. They do not realize it is Jesus. And Jesus is talking to them. And this is a long walk. This is a 2-hour walk, and it must have seemed just a very quick walk, like 5 minutes. And as Jesus is revealing the scriptures to them, revealing what that this death had to happen for him to come back to life, as he's revealing all this, their despair is turning into hope. And they're starting to understand, and they're moving from all those D words, depression and disillusionment and defeat. They're moving to hope. As this stranger explains that Jesus' death was a great part of God's plan for salvation, to save the world. But when disillusion and depression and defeat and disappointment overrule and dominate our lives, that's when Jesus wants to walk in. Jesus wants to walk in then with us and to lift us out of that. That's exactly what he did when he walked with these two men on the road to Emmaus. He points to God's word of promise in the Bible that tells us that we are God's dearly loved children. And that God will stand by us and with us through thick and thin. And that Jesus wants to turn our despair into hope. Now, I have a dear friend. I'm not going to mention her name. And she amazes me with her tenacity of spirit and her joy-filled life, despite her life maybe not being what she planned or expected it to be. And we've often been speaking about this coronavirus and how life is very different in the wake of it. And how she has to take certain precautions, but she's not terribly happy about. And yet, she'll say to me, "Heidi, I'm not afraid of the coronavirus. I do not live in a spirit of fear, for I know who I am, and I know whose I am, and I know where I'm going. So I'm not afraid, and I take comfort in it." And she is always so refreshing because she's not afraid. Life isn't all she hoped and dreamed it would be, but she's joyful in the Lord, and she finds comfort in knowing that maybe right now everything is not perfect. But her joy comes from the Lord, and her joy comes in knowing that this isn't it. There's more, more than we could ever dream of or imagine waiting for us. And that gives her hope for the future. So she refuses to live in a state of fear or defeat or disappointment. And she inspires me every single day. He gives her hope for the future and a hope that only Jesus can give. Now, life deals us hard blows. Life isn't always great and perfect and goes the way we want it to. And life, let's face it, there are extraordinary, fantastic moments in our lives. Magical moments, memories that we will cherish forever. But overall, life isn't always wonderful and perfect and fantastic. And right now, life seems strange and weird and not what we're used to. But often, life is just ordinary. But life also is sometimes painful. But I think in these moments of doubt, or worry, or pain, or anger, or frustration, or just, what is going on here, God? I think that's when we grow and learn the most. As I said in my little midweek message, that my Mary Martha message, that maybe this is absolutely the time to step back and reflect and see what God is actually doing in our lives and in the midst of this, to pause and find blessing and hope, because there is hope always to be had, even when life isn't going as we planned. These are the opportunities to have the opportunity to be alive and to encounter the risen Jesus, to discover what he has to offer, discover that no, he doesn't promise a life without heartache and pain and hurt and difficulty, but he does promise a life of ups and downs and challenges, but of great joy and hope and promise. And that's what I hold on to, because sometimes when we're down in the depths, we lose sight of what God is doing and how God is working, and we lose sight of the little blessings that can come out of the worst. And so these two men, I imagine, were doing a lot of that, focusing on the problem, focusing on the woe, focusing on the defeat, focusing on the disappointment, focusing on all that. That is why they couldn't recognize Jesus right away. Focusing on their problem, not focusing on Christ. Focusing within and our stuff stops us from focusing in on Christ. They did not recognize Jesus, but he recognized them. And his coming to them and walking alongside them illustrates the truth that Jesus promises, I am with you always. And this road to Emmaus is a road of companionship that indicates Jesus' desire to walk with each one of us. Even when we journey off the path, he wants to bring us back. The scriptures say, when you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. Do not be afraid, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by your name. You are mine. You are God's own. And he's with us. And so suddenly, the Epiphanes and his friend are standing in amazement after their eyes were revealed of who Jesus really was. They sat at dinner with him, and suddenly, this looks familiar. Jesus is breaking bread with us. That was Jesus. And they're excited. They encountered. Their eyes were revealed. Their eyes were opened. This was the risen Christ sitting, having supper with them, blessing them, teaching them. And their eyes were opened. And then Jesus was gone. Jesus was gone out of their sight. But he's not gone. He is still visible and present with all those who have eyes to see and eyes of faith. And so then in the scriptures tell us, having this knowledge now that indeed they saw for themselves that Jesus is alive and well and come back and wants to journey with us still, they leap and they run. The scriptures say they immediately went back to Jerusalem to tell the disciples what had happened, because that is what should happen when we encounter Jesus. When Jesus reveals himself to us in a personal way and we discover that yes, I want to walk with Jesus. I want to give my life to Jesus. We should be excited about that. Their hearts were on fire. They were exploding with this great news, and they had to rush back and tell their friends about it. And I wonder to you, my friends, when was the last time that Jesus gave you a little heartburn? And I mean in a good way, not the runny type of heartburn, but in a good way. Does Jesus make your heart burn? Does Jesus fill you with joy and excitement and love that you can't wait to share it with people? Because that's what's happening here. And that's what the road to Emmaus is all about. That our lives can be filled with despair and disappointment and discouragement and despondency and all those D words. And we can choose to walk with our heads down and stay there in the light of this coronavirus. We can stay there. Or we can choose to look up and allow ourselves to see Christ at work all around us, and allow ourselves to walk with Christ. He does bring joy. He does bring peace. He does bring hope. He does bring life. He has conquered death, and he wants us to have life in all its abundance. We may not be full of joy right now. I get it. I know that. But I also know the Lord Jesus Christ wants to bring us his joy, and he wants to journey with us. He promises us again, we don't walk this journey alone. Right now, I get it. We're walking a strange journey. Life seems to be a roller coaster of emotions right now, but we seem maybe stuck in the car because the pace of the world is going much slower. So our heads might be all over the place, but we're being called to be still in the midst of all that as well. We're not used to that. We're all walking a journey. We're all walking this corona journey together. We're walking it differently, some of us. I appreciate that. But we're not walking it alone. Remember, we are not walking this journey alone. We are never walking this journey alone. The unseen stranger, the risen Christ, Jesus, is walking with us. Thank you, God. We are going to sing a little more. We're going to sing another one of my favorite hymns. And this really is one I think you can belt it out to at home. Be Thou My Vision. Sorry for that slight technical difficulty there. That's Tony singing in the background and me not so much this week. Thank you, Tony. Let us pray. God of life and death and life beyond death, in this Easter season, we bring songs of praise and wonder for life that defeats death. As the seasons turn towards spring, as any snow is replaced with grass and soil, bringing the promise of new growth and life, we give thanks for all that makes life full and abundant, for family and friends who share our lives, our care, our celebration, even if now it needs to be from a distance, for fresh green shoots pushing their way out of frozen soil, for food on our tables and roofs over our heads, for the ability to stay at home and the resources to keep us clean and safe. For these and many other things, we give thanks to you, loving God. At the same time, source of life and love, we pause to remember those near and far who are struggling today. For those whom staying at home is not a possibility as they head out to their jobs and worry. For those who look for their next meal. For those who are fretting over how to make rent. For those who worry about a loved one's physical, mental, spiritual, or emotional health. For those who are worrying about their own physical, mental, spiritual, or emotional health. For those who feel they are just treading water, fighting to keep above the waves. God of love, may all those who struggle know they are not alone. Loving Lord, we thank you for all those who are working for us to make life better, easier, for we know they are worried themselves. We think of all those families who have lost loved ones to the coronavirus. We pray for all those who are battling the illness right now. May you bring healing. May you bring hope. May you bring peace. Lord, we pray for your patience. We pray for your strength. We pray for your wisdom. We pray for your compassion. We pray for your love. Help us to love one another. Help us to shine your light in the darkest of places. Give us eyes to see and give us your hearts to love. Help us shine our lights to those who feel in a very dark place. And help all your children near and far, all those tuning in, know they are loved, lavishly loved, and they do not walk this road alone. We pray all these things in your precious name. Amen. And we'll close this morning with our final blessing. The words are here, and it's to the tune of Edelweiss. The Lord mighty God, bless and keep you forever. Give you peace, perfect peace, courage in every endeavor. Lift up your eyes and you'll see His face, full of grace forever. The Lord mighty God, bless and keep you forever. We have paused for a time of worship. As we go out to the rest of our day, the rest of our week, I know we carry our doubts, but we also carry our faith. We carry our questions, our worries, but we carry our trust. And we use all of them and determine how God would have us live and love one another. In all of this, God, risen Christ, and Holy Spirit is with us. Thanks be to God. Amen. God bless. Keep safe. Thank you for joining us today. Bye-bye.